Afternoon, I'm going to try to move quickly. It's interesting to me that no matter where in the world I go, I keep running to the bobsled thing, which is a good thing because I have the bruises to show for it, so I feel that I can get some benefit out of it. So I'm watching TV, and I see the President of the United States get up on stage not too far from here and starts his speech by saying, "Greetings, massive." And everybody went wild, and then he went into a speech, "Greetings, massive, wagwan." Everybody here knows that legendary now all over the social media. And then went in to have a fearless, strong criticism or fearless, stoutly defend gay rights, fairly, clearly say that the legalization of marijuana is not on the horizon, topics which normally will solicit the vile of our population, and everybody clapped. And this to me is the power of charisma. And so I took back up my book, I thought about Michael Manley and so on, and decided to speak about, to do some more research in charisma. It's actually one of the chapters from my dissertation that I may not be able to use because it's getting too big, so I just wanted to share some thoughts with you on that. I have it in a Word document, but I'll just go through it, you know. Charisma actually started, for those of you who are in the church, from the charisms which Peter spoke about, the gifts of the Spirit. But from an academic point of view, it goes back to Aristotle in his book, in his work called The Rhetoric, where he says, a leader must gain the confidence of his followers by using creative rhetorical means. These include rousing follower emotions, and see if you recognize any of these as you think about charismatic leaders. Providing a moral perspective via personal character, ethos, using reasoned argument, or what we call logos. And when I think about Aristotle writing this in BC, and it's still being the foundations of charismatic theory in 2015, it's just absolutely astounding to me. Following on him is the great sociologist Max Weber, who identified in his book three types of legitimate rule: traditional authority, legal rational authority, and charismatic authority. And charismatic authority is the one that he had a particularly fond enjoyment of. Traditional, of course, is like the monarchy. Legal rational is if you get elected or appointed by way of law, then you're a legal rational, you have legal rational authority. And charisma really just comes from the person. He points out, though, which is very important, that charismatic leadership flourishes in times of psychic, physical, economic, ethical, religious, or political distress. So it is something that works in times of hardship, not when things are necessarily going well. And it's important to remember that, because where I'm going with this paper is to try to see why, whether and under what circumstances, charismatic leadership is effective in Jamaican organizations. And that is the direction I'm going in. Again, just from an academic point of view, there's work by Etzioni in 1964, who identified three types of power: physical power, which is where you're bigger, you're stronger, use of threats; material power, you can give or withhold rewards; and symbolic power, which entails the use of normative or social power, which symbolic power correlates well with charismatic power. Going on to the work of Downton, and I'm just giving you a survey now of the development of thought leadership on charisma. Downton proposed a theory of transactional, charismatic, and inspirational leadership in the context of revolution. And most of the time that we see charismatic leadership, it is in a traumatic national occurrence. The corporate leaders who have been charismatic usually come in to save a company that is going through some distress, and the companies will go outside of their ranks to bring in this charismatic leader who is expected to come in and save the day. And we have seen many, many examples of that, particularly in the United States. And just by way of footnote, not to predetermine the research, but it has not really worked. In fact, many of the more effective leaders in the US context are simply not charismatic. One of the most successful companies in the US is, for example, a company called 3M. And I would bet my lunch money today that nobody here knows who the president of 3M is. but it is still the most effective, one of the most successful companies in the world. Now, he makes an important distinction, which I think I'll come back to later, that we tend to conflate charismatic leadership with inspirational leadership. And they are, in fact, there's an argument that can be made that they are, in fact, separate. In other words, you can be inspirational without being charismatic, and vice versa. Inspirational leadership is independent of charismatic leadership, according to Downton. Inspirational leadership does not foster follower dependence on the leader. All right? It does not foster follower dependence on the leader, which is why it is not very useful in politics, because there's an argument to be made that in politics, there's something to be said for the follower to be dependent on you. Charisma tends to engender that. Inspirational leadership doesn't engender that. And as we go forward in the literature, you find that while charismatic leadership continues to be included in all theories of leadership, the inspirational component, or the tack of inspirational versus pure charismatic, is gaining more prominence. House, who was later be involved in a very important study on culture and leadership worldwide called the Globe Study, presented an integrated theoretical framework and testable proposition to explain the behavior of charismatic leaders. And this, by the way, turned out to be a magnus opus piece of work in leadership theory and those leadership theory development. And those of you here who are, you know, academics and, you know, wish to be professors and so on, I found it interesting in that one of his interviews, he said his greatest regret was that he published this paper as a chapter in a book and not in a peer-reviewed article, so it never got a lot of attention early on, which to me is interesting. Same words, but it never went through the rigor, the crucible of peer review, so it was actually ignored for many, many years. So, I mean, make a note of that. Get your articles published in peer review if you want them to be taken seriously, even at that level. Charismatic leaders focused on the psychological impact, this is according to House, of leaders on followers. This is very important. How do I affect the follower? Refer to charismatic leaders as having the necessary persuasive skills to influence others. This is House in 1977, who is looking remarkably like Aristotle. He described the personal characteristics of charismatic leaders. Remember, a lot of charisma comes from the person. Suggested that individual differences of charismatic leaders might be measurable, which was important for the academics. As academia moved more towards quantitative methods of research, there was a need to not sort of take the Aristotle or Weber or John Smith approach to analysis, which is sort of, you know, using words and moving more towards quantifiable measures. And he brought that to the table in terms of studying leaders. He proposed that the basis for charismatic appeal is the emotional interaction that occurs between followers and leaders, and this is very important. It doesn't require other kinds of leadership. If you go back to Weber, you talk about traditional and legal forms. It doesn't require that you know, in those kind of leaders, you can just give instructions and people follow it. In charismatic leadership, there needs to be an emotional connection between the leader and the follower. And I want to stick up in here and point out, just to show you where I'm going. I want to see if the Jamaican culture is supportive of charismatic leadership. So that, you know, is there something that in the Jamaican culture, and I'm going to talk about national culture different from organizational culture, and something in Jamaican culture which would allow us as followers or to make an emotional connection with leaders and therefore at least improve the efficacy from a follower point of view of leadership. Now, of the leader. So, and let me make a point clear here. Not because I'm following you in earnest means that you're a good leader. So there are two different dimensions there. So I intend to measure the strength of the relationship with the charismatic leader, but I also intend to look at the effectiveness of the charismatic leader. And when I speak to effectiveness, I'm going to look at the impact of the charismatic leader on the organization. Because what we are going to find is that we all love and follow the charismatic leader, but that does not necessarily mean that that charismatic leader generates good results in the organization, which is very important, okay? Charismatic leaders have certain behaviors, still by host, display confidence in their own abilities, great deal of confidence, believe in self-efficacy. They set high expectations for themselves, they show confidence. They expect their followers to follow them and do as they are doing. And they engage in image building and self-promotion actions to come across as powerful. This is all very important, and as a matter of fact, many religions are founded based on this. In 1978, Burns came out with a leadership theory that looked at transactional and transformational leadership. Transactional leadership, simply put, is where I do something for you and you do something for me. Then he had that at one end of the spectrum. At the other end, he had transforming leadership, which sought to, not transformational, transforming leadership. Transformational leadership comes later with the work of Bastard in 1985. Transforming leadership raised the consciousness of followers such that I buy into what you're saying, I believe in what you're trying to do, and I'm coming along with you for the journey. Moving on to Bass, whose work really forms the basis of my dissertation now, I'm looking at transformational leadership impact on the impact of transformational leadership on the performance of on the stability of financial institutions in Jamaica. So I'm actually going about measuring the 9 factors of transformational leadership theory. On a transformational, and these are again constructs under leadership, and I'm going to demonstrate now how they come from charisma. Transformational leadership, the first 3 components, idealized influence means I look up to what you're doing and I idealize it and therefore I want to do it. There are 2 types. Attributed, meaning to say that the person is out there doing what they're doing and you of your own accord attribute those virtues to that person. The second type of idealized influence is behavior, which is that I am behaving in such a way that you wish to emulate me. All right, so that's a closer connection and based on things that I actually do as opposed to something that you're, a virtue that you're simply giving me at a distance. Then there's inspirational motivation. In other words, you know, we are down and out, it's sort of the halftime speech when you're down 2-0 and it's halftime. And it's, you know, let's get up and go and win the match at the end of the day. That's the sort of inspirational leadership. Now, these 5 are the heart of transformational leadership theory. It is interesting to note that the first 3 are directly derived from charisma. Idealized influence in its both forms, inspirational motivation, are directly derived from charisma. So charisma continues to have a very high impact on leadership theory. Then you have intellectual stimulation and individualized consideration, which I'm not focusing on for this paper. Then on the transactional side, you have contingent rewards. If you do this well, then I'll reward you. If not, I'll withhold something. Management by exception. If it works well, I'll leave you alone. If it doesn't work well, you're going to get a phone call from me. And passive avoidant leadership, which is non-leadership. You're just there. It's management by exception, active, so you don't do the job. People here may know that. You say, okay, so what? You know, that's the way it goes. All right, let me speak a little bit about culture now, and it's very important. Gert Hofstede, through his book, Culture's Consequences, that came out in 1980, provided 4 categories for national culture. Power distance, uncertainty avoidance, individualism, masculine, feminine. It showed Jamaica scores. I don't know if you can get to that page, but I'll go through it here. So these are 4 ways in which you can measure culture in a country. So I'm going to now go through and explain to you where Jamaica falls within this these metrics for culture. Jamaica on power distance is the relationship between people. The dimension is the fact that all individuals in our society are not equal. It expresses the attitudes of cultures towards these inequalities. So high power distance means that, oh, I am just here, you know, like the Mexicans would say, in Gabriel Garcia's book, when he says to the lady working in the house, who is that? And she answers and she says, no one, sir, it's just me. So that's a high power distance culture. You know, not like Jamaica and says, me, what you want? You know, it's a different perception of relationships. So Jamaica is very much a low power distance, which, by the way, I don't think was always the case. I think coming out of slavery, we were probably high power distance. We were, you know, yes, background, blah, blah, blah. Somewhere between Manly and Patterson that disappeared, and I think is worthy of some research. Independence, hierarchy for convenience only. Equal rights. I travel around the Caribbean, and people say no matter how lowly a Jamaican worker is, do not disrespect them, and that's part of our culture. Individualism. Jamaica's score is low. It's considered a collectivist society. What does that mean? Family is important. Family is more important than laws and regulations. How many times have I seen that? Or my relationship with my friends is more important than the law of the land or the expectation. How many times you go to somewhere and the door lock, but it's your friend and they open the door and let you in? Right? That is part of the Jamaican culture. So we score a 39 on individualism, which means that we are a collectivist society. Masculine, feminine. Masculine is, I am the Don, I do what I'm doing. Feminine means, let's all get together and solve the problems. No prizes for guessing if we're masculine or feminine. A masculine society, managers are expected to be decisive and assertive. Emphasis on equity, I work, he must give me what I'm worth. My gardener makes that point to me, there's no sort of, you know, issues with that. Uncertainty avoidance. Jamaicans are extremely comfortable with uncertainty. Many cultures are not. They want to see a clear path to the future. Jamaicans are extremely comfortable with uncertainty. What does that mean? It means that when you have a fear of the future, then it is more likely that you want a particular kind of leader. We are self-deterministic people, so the leader can do what they want to do, but we have our destiny in our control. And you see this in America. You see Jamaicans going there and making their own way, and who want to be prejudiced and who want to not give Social Security, that is their issue. Jamaicans make their way independent of that, which is an important characteristic for the country. Now, going on to put a fine point on it now, there are a plethora of studies that make the point that the type of culture that you have impacts the type of leadership that works. All right? If I am a masculine, if I have a masculine culture and you come to me and say, let us sit down together and you know, you decide, we're not gonna relate to that. I'm saying, man, you know, what kind of man that? You know what I mean? We want that masculine leadership. At the same time, we're a collectivist. So even though I'm looking towards you to make that decision and be assertive, don't push it down my throat. All right? You can't force me to do it. You have to engage me. All right? So the point that I'm going to get to in the research ultimately is, given the nature of charismatic leadership, which is inspirational, which tries to get you to follow the leader and do what the leader says based on the leader's personality alone, regardless of the environment or the arguments, the logos or the ethos. Would the Jamaican culture, as I just described to you, be able to, would it support charismatic leadership? In short, can a charismatic leader be successful in the context of Jamaica? Now, there are two types of cultures, mainly that we are dealing with. There's a professional culture, there's a third one, but we're dealing with national culture and organizational culture. I'm going to be focusing on the organizational culture. So the question that we wish to get into is, given how the Jamaican people are, by and large and in whole, and that's the nature of culture, the definition of culture, not that you say so, but as a group, this is how we are. If I come forward as a charismatic organizer, a charismatic president, two questions. Are you more likely to follow me or to view me as a charismatic? And by the way, interestingly, charismatic leadership is ultimately given by the follower. The follower power remains very strong in this relationship. And equally, and I'll squeeze this in before I end, charismatic leadership by the follower can be as easily withdrawn as it is given. This is very important because plenty of people start out being very charismatic and then they don't deliver results. And you know how people are, all of a sudden you fall from grace. You know, nobody's paying attention to you anymore. It's very important to understand and study in charisma as a leadership aspect and culture in Jamaica. So what I'm proposing to go forward with in the study, or suggested research, but if you can get to that last page or second to last, is to examine a national culture response to charismatic leadership. Now you're going to say to me that, I mean, we have had some of the greatest charismatic leaders in the Caribbean. You're going to say to me, Buster, and you're going to say to me, Michael Manley, and I'm not sure that we have had very strong charismatic leaders outside of those two. But we related to those guys, and some people say that Manley would have been prime minister as long as he wanted based on his charismatic leadership. But does that work? Is that true? How do you compare that to Siaga, who is sort of blah, or PJ, who was, but you know, did what he has to do, PJ, who was equally blah, but also pursued his own policies and practices. And so the question is, does that cause us to follow the person more and get better results? Or frankly, do we get better results from transactional leaders or other types of leadership styles as opposed to charismatic? So another organization we're going to look at, and my watch is buzzing, which dimensions of culture enhance or reduce the efficacy of charismatic leadership. We're going to look at the impact of normative or chaotic conditions, as said to you, as Weber said. When things are going haywire, it is easy. We welcome charismatic leaders. Charisma versus inspirational leaders. In other words, you inspire me, but I'm not necessarily in awe of you, so to speak. And the impact of dissolution of charismatic power, it doesn't work. When it falls apart and you don't have a bureaucracy, you don't have traditional authority, what happens in the organization? And finally, the efficacy of bureaucratic versus charismatic power and leadership. Meaning to say, we may find that a legal approach, whichever you're appointed or you're elected, or a traditional approach, means to say that you have inherited power, may be more effective in organizational results, like in family businesses, than charismatic leadership. And so we don't know the answers to this, and I think it's worthwhile finding out to inform our leadership development persons and persons who are hiring people into leadership positions in organizations in Jamaica. Thank you very much.
I'd like to acknowledge